Welcome back to the Stan Simpson Show. We're talking about the book Dutch Point, a notorious Hartford project, a fictional account about a very real project that's now and changed now. The new Dutch Point now is single family homes. Talk about that. I mean, it's gone from one of the worst housing projects in the city to townhouses, a rebirth there. Your thoughts about the new Dutch Point?
Yeah, well, it's a transformation completely, because that's not the Dutch Point that I was actually writing about. Mm. You know, as an investigator, I have many cases in the old Dutch Point. And, you know, this is a good look for the city also. You know, it's showing, you know, that we can find housing for our families and housing that you'll be, you know, happy and proud of to live in. Not to say that the people that were living in the old Dutch Point weren't. They were very, happy people and proud of where they're from. It's just unfortunately, such as Dutch Point or any other area within the city, you're going to have people that are doing bad things.
Let's be honest, though, those products turn into basically barracks, sort of jail barracks, right?
Yeah, unfortunately.
How much does the environment contribute to this function? When you house people in a place with bars and it's an old sort of barrack-style situation,
right?
How much that contribute to self-esteem, self-image, and what you have to deal with?
Well, it could be the mindset. I mean, if you, as a resident of any place, feel that, you know, because I'm poor or because I don't have this much, this is, you know, where I'm supposed to be. You know, it gives a family sometimes a sense of that they can't make it out of a situation like that, that they can't break out of a situation. And I think that that was a very powerful move in order to renovate that the housing project. When they made it in the 1940s, the families, they weren't as big as they ended up being. You know, you had a situation in the project where, you know, you had not only the rodents and the insect infestations, but the place was falling apart, you know. And as the families and multi-generational of families residing in the place, you can only imagine what's going to occur on top of the violence.
It became a lower priority, let's be honest, right? It became a lower priority for the city and therefore a haven for drug use and violence, et cetera. Now, you're also big on Hartford history, and you're saying that, you know, as we're talking about Mark Twain and sort of the city's responsibility to uphold what it was in the past, both the folks who live here, folks who work here. Talk about your affinity for Hartford's history.
Well, that it was interesting. I mean, by being a resident of Hartford for the past 10 years and working over the past 12, it's a parallel that I even wanted to catch for myself of residing in a place that I somewhat neglected, you know. Neglected in the sense of, I wanted to draw the parallel from the character Andrew. He's an investigator that investigates abuse and neglect on a daily basis. But he neglects the same city, neglecting in regards to interacting with his neighbors, maybe not even paying attention to the history. You know, I live across the street from the Coat Factory, you know.
A lot of history there, right?
A lot of history there, you know, knowing the importance of walking down, you know, near Mark Twain's house. These are very important people that resided in our state, and some people have never been in the Mark Twain house, me being one of them. You know,
when you have that history, when they have that appreciation, you become more of a stakeholder, right?
Exactly.
You learn to treat the city better when you know its rich history.
Exactly. And I mean, I think one of the fascinating things is, and through the research that I was doing in order, I wanted Hartford to be a main character. What connects the reader to the characters is because of Hartford and through Hartford. Hartford is like that glue. Hartford was that extra character that sat in the background telling the stories as the characters walk through the city. You know, having the highlights of, you know, me not knowing that there was a river that passed through Hartford. You know, just in the research, I kind of pulled that up and the significance of that. You know, and as I said, the important people such as Mark Twain, the Harriet Beecher Stowe's of the kind, residing in a city. You know, it was a very beautiful city.
Let me say real quick, 30 seconds. Dads, lack of male role models in the household you're going to. To what degree are the lack of males an issue when you go in and do your investigations and deal with your cases? Well, how much of it deals with males not being accountable or involved?
Well, many times you will find workers, you go out and sometimes the families wouldn't provide you with the names or the contact information. And the old DCF, I would say, was like, okay, whatever, let's move on. But I think that DCF is now making an initiative to locate these fathers, mm-hmm. to make them accountable. We have a lot of father-to-father programs that are giving the father services.
Would you agree that that's a major issue?
That is a major issue. I mean, sometimes the connection that these children need to their father, you know, like Cassandra in the book, who was her father? I mean, I don't want to blow the story, but having that connection, having that role model, having that person that you can look up to is a very important role for any child to have both of the parents. But at times, I know we can't.
Even quicker, education, 5 seconds. You go into these homes, investigate the drama, dysfunction, lack of strong male role models, mm-hmm. education, how much does that affect?
Education is one of the most important. Education is what's going to get you out of that poverty. Education is going to pull you and possibly pull your family out.
All right, his name is Kareem Muhammad, folks. The book is called Dutch Point. When we return, we'll catch up with our sports maven, Scott Gray from WTIC-AM. What does that mean, that March Madness now for UConn, both the men and women? We'll get his insight. Don't forget, you can catch our show 24/7 at ctnow.com/Stan. Don't go away. ¶¶